please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Welcome back. It's flat for the market. So let's talk about some stocks that have been giving great returns to investors. Mahindra & Mahindra is one of them. The monsoon season is in full glory and the MSP prices have been hiked. I did catch up with Rajesh Jejurikar, the president of the farm equipment sector, last evening to know more about the demand situation. Here's a slice of that conversation.
The wrong place to judge monsoons, but yes, it is raining well and raining well all through the country. So it's been a good spread so far. And obviously that we know leads to very good sentiment in the market. And we're seeing that over the last 2-3 months again, where the market is in good momentum. As you said, quarter one has been good. And it's good based on some good rural fundamentals. And we believe one of the driving factors, even before the MSP announcement, has been non-farm income. And the infusion of money happening in rural India because of infrastructure development, roads, toilets, and so on, is all helping bring in new cash in rural economy. And then the money moves in to an important asset class, especially when the agri outlook is good. So all in all, we see a good season ahead.
Okay, a good season ahead. You know, we've had now, what, almost 3 years of good tractor growth.
Right.
But after two good years, sometimes come two bad years, right?
Yeah.
Is there a possibility of a couple of bad years for the tractor industry as well?
If you look at the last 10 years, we have a CAGR of 10%. So our view always is you have to look at the tractor industry based on a longer term fundamental, and that 10% CAGR reflects that. In the tractor demand cycle, there will always be one or two bad years and some good years. And as an organization, we prepare ourselves for both the scenarios. So right now the scenario is there's a demand uptick and we are moving to make sure that we're able to maximize supplies and outputs. And there will be years when we're moving in the reverse direction, when we have to bring supply down and bring our costs down so that we protect our margins. So all in all, we believe we have a very agile supply chain and we maximize the output depending on what the demand outlook is.
Well, you know, the reason I asked you about the possibility of a couple of bad years is because at your farm day in Nagpur, you spoke about how you're looking to increase the global business.
Yeah.
Is that a hedging strategy in case there are a few bad years in the domestic market, grow your global business?
The reason we are going global is because there's such a big upside out of going global. There's a very, very large global market for farm equipment, and that's $150 billion. Tractors is just $55 billion out of that. So you have $100 billion of non-tractor global business opportunity. So really the driver to our strategy is when there is such a big upside available, we have to think beyond being just a domestic tractor player because we have so much headroom for growth. We find that in many parts of the world, our products are perfectly suitable because the climatic conditions or the soil conditions are very similar to what we have here in India. So really we have an opportunity to leverage that, and that's the driver of our global strategy. The fact that it could de-risk us is just an added add-on bonus, but that's not the driver of the strategy. The driver of the strategy is there is an upside, let's go and get it.
What is the scope of the business now in terms of hiring tractors? How much could that business grow? And also transplanters, harvesters, you know, the non-tractor equipment business, how much could that grow?
You mean by way of new sale?
By way of new, yes. Revenue potential,
yeah.
Basically.
So if you look at India right now, about less than 20% of the total business is from non-tractors. If you look at it global, it's almost reversed. So just 30-odd% is tractors. The rest is mechanization or other farm machinery. So over a period of time, we think India is going to keep adding newer mechanization solutions going beyond tractors. We believe it's our role as a leader to enable that to happen. If I anecdotally again take the example of China, China is actually has lesser paddy than India. And China sells over 100,000 rice transplanters. India sells 2,000. So that is the order of magnitude difference between a country like China and how they have moved on mechanization versus how we are.
Okay. So coming back to the number game, you know, you've spoken about an 8 to 10% growth, compounded growth over the next 3 to 4 years. What are you looking at immediately in FY19? In the first quarter, you've done 1 lakh units. You think this 1 lakh run rate is something that's sustainable? Could you do better than that in the next 2 to 3 quarters?
Well, for the year, firstly, we talk only industry for the year. So industry for the year, we had said at the beginning of the year, will be 8 to 10%. We're still holding on to that because normally we would take a fresh view sometime in the coming quarter based on how we see the spread of monsoons and all the other factors. So at this point of time, we are still on 8 to 10%. Like you rightly said, quarter one has been very good. But we were expecting that. Even a month back, we had said we were expecting quarter one to be in the mid-teens. It's a little higher than that. So we'll see how the rest of the year pans out. But quarter one, like you said, has been a good start. And MSPs is good news. Yeah. Rains is good news. So let's hope for the best.
You know, on the margins, you've been in this 17 to 20% band for a long time. In fact, now you've got to 20% plus. So your return on capital employed is actually 100% in that sense. Are you going to continue to maintain these margins, or are you going to sacrifice some of your margins to invest into, say, advertising, R&D, marketing, etc., in order to grow your market share?
Well, at any point of time in a business cycle, one has to prioritize what needs to be done. From a pricing to consumer standpoint, based on what's happening to material costs or commodity price, which is really the margin calculation, and what are the investments needed in the business. We believe we have made all the investments over the last 3 years needed to ensure growth of our business. So we've had 3 full new platforms, I think one of them right here,
yeah.
Novo. So we've had 3 new platforms come out from the Mahindra stable. We've had Swaraj doing a new high horsepower platform.
Yeah.
We believe we are very well placed on installed capacities.
Mm.
And we have done global growth acquisitions, alliances, etc. Mm. So we believe we have done all the right things which will create the ground for future growth. Mm. So our strategy will always be to balance growth with the right investments and the building blocks for the future. So it's really a combination of managing financial performance and top-line growth in the most efficient way.
So if all the investments have been made, then you think you can do better than 20% margins in the tractor business?
Margins is a function of not just investment, right? So in ROCE is affected by investment in a direct way.
Yeah.
Margin is affected by
the raw material
pricing,
cost,
commodity prices.
So are you seeing a lot of pressure there?
Commodity prices have been really escalated in the last year or two. We always are the leader in taking price increases.
Yeah.
We go ahead of the market and take the price increases. And we believe our brands generally have the ability to do so. That being said, there is competition in the industry and there is so much the consumer is willing to pay for at any point of time. So we have to balance these trade-offs by seeing what's the right price increase, what is the commodity increase, and what other areas of cost we need to cut back on so that we keep our margins in a band.
5 years hence, where do you see this business? I mean, how much do you think the how much capacity does it have to grow, both India and global, over the next 5 years?
We believe there's a big upside on both global because we are not there. And we can get into farm machinery space in select segments. We can get stronger in tractors by getting into newer markets we haven't been in. And in the domestic space, we believe that there will be a lot of investment in agriculture, in rural. And we believe that the domestic tractor industry will move at a pace of at least 8 to 10% over the next 5 years. And hence, there is a big upside for tractors. And farm machinery is completely unexplored in India. So we think that will grow big as well.
Okay, so that's a sea change happening. Sea change is almost a pun over here. You've been doing it with so much rain all around this interview. But yes, the sea change that M&M is pointing to is that Indian labor has become expensive, not wanting to do hard labor as well. And therefore, their transplanters, not just their tractors, but even their transplanters, is finding a lot of demand. This is an interesting conversation. We'll replay it for you. It's available in CNBCTV18.com as well and on our Facebook page. But this is pointing out to some seminal changes. Mm. And of course, M&M is on the cusp to take advantage. But on the cusp to take advantage of the markets also were our tech gurus. All of them pointed out that Bank Nifty would be a buy on dips. Ashwini reiterated that after 9:15, and he said that he's already long and the Nifty Bank is showing a much stronger tendency. And since then, at that time, it was less than a quarter percent higher. Now, half a percent higher on the Nifty Bank. So the men in the money are with us. Ashwini, if someone missed that call, is it good to go long on the Nifty Bank even now? Does it look like a trending higher day?
See, the problem is that, you are sitting now on from yesterday's low of, I think, about a 400-point rally on Bank Nifty. So the early morning trade was that there are probably some more shorts which need to be covered. But now your stop is at 26,260. I don't think people will be able to take that stop, A. B, there is way too much red that is happening. Globally, also half the market is lower. The declines are almost in step with advances. So I don't think, you should push your luck on a day like today. Plus, there is Bank Nifty expiry. So what we have done is we have taken money off on the Bank Nifty positions that we took. And now from here, Reliance AGM expiry, things will get a bit mucky and, volatile. So if you are holding on, maybe, use a trailing stop and hold on. But I don't think you should get in now. Having said that, when do you get in? If you get a dip, if something happens and, Nifty falls 40 points, then that would be a dip that you want to buy. For the moment, Yes Bank is a buy with a stop of 337. Target of 352. L&T Finance is a buy with a stop of 144, target of 156. India Cement is a buy with a stop of 104, target of 116.
Okay, I'm glad you mentioned India Cements because that was my next question. We are seeing a sudden move in all the cement stocks this morning. India Cements, of course, is topping that list right now, but it has company in the form of Ultratech Cements as well. That stock is up 2.5%. Mitesh, this is one pocket that has started to move now, lately, over the last few weeks. You expect more trades in the cement space and anything else that you're looking at?
Yeah, in fact, I do have ACC on my list, and I think I do like most of the cement pack, but the best ones would be ACC and Ultratech. I think, they've done good base building and now are reversing. So I think I would be comfortable buying into both of them. But the recommendation right now is ACC, which is a buy with a stop at 1360 for targets of 1420. And as Ashwin was mentioning, I think, the banking pack remains a favorite. We had a buy call on the Bank Nifty yesterday, which we are following through today. And amongst the banking lot, Yes Bank appears to be giving some kind of a breakout. I think Ashwin also covered this stock. Good technical setup over here. That's a buy with a stop at 336. Look for 356 as the first target.
Okay. Actually, if you remember, Ultratech Cement was also Sudarshan's call. So I think today, a lot of our technical guys are in some serious money. Yes Bank as well, if you remember right, Ashwini had pointed out, now sitting at 3% gains, Yes Bank. Ultratech sitting at 2.25% gains. So big gains here. Rajat Bose is also with us. Good morning to you, Rajat. What would you trade now?
Good morning to you all. I would trade one power company, one automobile, and one cement company. To start with, the cement company, ACC, I would put a stop loss below 1368 and target would be 1397 to 1403. Cement companies are doing well today and cement companies have been doing well lately. So this bullishness is likely to continue. And Calcutta Electric, CESC, I would put a stop loss below 895 since it has taken out 900. Now it is well set to scale up higher levels. 916 and 920 are two of my targets. And finally, a sell call on Tata Motors. Tata Motors, our major support is around 250. 251 is my target. But prior to that, 255 could well act as a minor support. And Tata Motors, one thing I would like to add here is that it's not a bargain even at 250. If 250 is decisively taken out, it will see sub 200 levels going forward. So be wary of taking long positions as a bargain in Tata Motors. It isn't.
Okay, a lot of people talking about sub 200 in Tata Motors, Sudarshan Sukhani as well as Rajat. But Rajat, since we are talking about Calcutta-based companies, Eveready is also doing pretty well this morning, up about 3-odd%. Any trades there?
You are talking about Eveready Industries?
Yes.
Not a chart you're seeing.
Yeah, I'm not so certain. Okay. I mean, I don't track this company so closely, so I would not like to comment.
Okay. At home, so probably just buying the products and not the stock. Well, Ashwini, I wanted to ask you about M&M as well. I mean, I'm taking off from the very interesting conversation Sonia had with the management, and now they're finding a lot of market for their transplanters because of labor shortages in rural India. Now, the point is it's got a good day today. 1.5 higher could be one of those MSP buys. But will it find a roof at 9:30 as it did in the previous occasions, or is it good to go further?
See, after being a dog for a very long time, it's now started to bark. So news, etc., doesn't really matter. The stock is at new highs, and from there, I think next target we should easily get 1,000, 1,050. There are those 20 stocks which are new high stocks. You keep buying corrections, they'll keep making new highs. This is in that category. Auto, you know, half the auto sector is not doing so well, but Maruti, M&M, these are the stocks that you want to get in, maybe even Escorts.
Fair point. Gentlemen, we'll of course keep coming back to you for more advice. Thank you very much for joining us with your 10 a.m. trades. 10 a.m. also means commodity trades, and Manisha Gupta has joined us to give us a roundup. Good morning, Manisha, again.
Thank you so much for that, Lata. Well, some pressure continuing in case of the crude oil prices. Yesterday, we saw no cues really coming in from the U.S. and Asia actually has started on a weaker note. So nearly a percentage point of a decline in the global markets. And that's exactly how the Indian space also has opened. Though the fundamentals clearly are not all bearish here. One, of course, is that the U.S. president tweeting, telling OPEC to start immediately reducing the prices and increase production substantially. Well, that really seems to have pulled the prices slightly on the weaker side. But whether or not that happens, how is the follow-up on that is what the markets would want to watch out for. But one thing that clearly has been supportive is Iran threatening to disrupt shipments in the neighboring areas as well. So again, if that is just a rhetoric, then the markets perhaps will not pay too much attention to that. But we need to see on what follows on to that too. In the meanwhile, you also are looking at the US weekly inventory data that is due today. There are outages, slippages in output from Nigeria, Libya and Algeria, etc. So that is something that wouldn't really lead to crude oil prices falling much below from where we are trading at this point in time. The US dollar, in the meanwhile, has taken a bit of a pause. It is the US Fed meeting minutes release in the evening. And ahead of that, there is some pressure that we have seen building up in case of the precious metal space. Off its lows, we did see a one-week highs in gold prices yesterday, but there hasn't been a follow-through buying since then. So very flat on your screen, silver yet to start trading is how we are looking at the precious metals. The base metal prices saw a complete sell-off in the LME yesterday, and Shanghai has opened much weaker on the lower side. 3.5% of decline is what we saw come in for zinc. Copper prices opened 3% down as well. But the point here really is that the LME markets had already declined yesterday, and Shanghai seems to be following up on that. And LME, in the meanwhile, today is trading quite flat. So it is really mixed cues coming in from those two major players when it comes to the metal space. So it's all divided really when you look at cues in the trading session. But we have trading calls coming in from the Angel Commodities. For copper, they have a sell with targets of 432. They also have a sell in case of the crude oil prices, where they expect the prices to decline all the way to 5,060 for the day today.
Okay, Manisha, thanks as always for giving us a quick snapshot on what's happening in the commodity space. For now, we'll take a short break. But up next, Soumitra Bhattacharya, the Managing Director of Bosch, will join in to talk about the early trends.